It is outrageous that they are demanding that confidential information be shared.
It really looks a lot like there is coordination between the White House and some of his allies.
The president has every right to find out what's going on here.
This is a defense strategy. Put the government on trial.
President Trump meeting with South Korea's president amid growing doubts over the summit with Kim Jong-un.
Some of the cheery optimism that we were feeling has dissipated as North Korea continues to criticize South Korea.
Clearly the president's still willing to walk away.
Well, there's no question.
This is New Day with Chris Cuomo and Allison Camerota.
Good morning. Welcome to your New Day. The Justice Department and the FBI are agreeing to share highly classified information related to the Russia investigation with lawmakers. Here come the leaks, and this is all about this meeting with the president, who demanded details about a confidential FBI source that he claims, without any real proof, that this was proof of spying on his campaign for political purposes. White House Chief of Staff John Kelly will set up a meeting for congressional leaders to review the classified materials. So, what will the Justice Department be showing, and what will this mean going forward?
And it's a big day ahead for the president. He hosts South Korea President Moon to discuss details of the negotiations with Kim Jong-un. But 3 weeks before the North Korean summit is supposed to happen, it may now be in question. So we begin our coverage with CNN's Caitlin Collins. She is live at the White House. What's the latest there, Caitlin?
Well, Allison, for now, the conflict between the president and the Department of Justice seems to have diffused temporarily, at least. That comes 24 hours after we were bracing for a showdown after the president demanded that the Department of Justice investigate the investigators of the Russia probe. And now, after a meeting with top law enforcement officials here at the White House, the sides seem to have come to an agreement. But now, Allison, the question is, who got the upper hand?
The White House brokering an agreement, announcing that top FBI and Justice Department officials have agreed to meet with congressional leaders to review highly classified information about the handling of the Russia probe. The detente coming after President Trump met with Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein, FBI Director Christopher Wray, and the Director of National Intelligence Dan Coats on Monday. The development coming one day after President Trump demanded an investigation into alleged infiltration or surveillance of his campaign, though the White House says this meeting was set up in advance. The Justice Department later asking its Inspector General to investigate the president's concerns.
We're very confident that as the Inspector General has been doing their work looking at the conduct of the FBI during that period, that by adding their focus to this, that we'll get to the bottom of it because the American people have a right to know.
Press Secretary Sarah Sanders noting that Chief of Staff John Kelly will immediately set up the meeting with congressional leaders, though it remains unclear who will be invited and what information will be shared. The Justice Department has resisted turning over classified material subpoenaed by House Intelligence Committee Chairman Devin Nunes about the early steps of the Russia investigation and a confidential source who spoke with at least three Trump campaign officials in 2016.
The day that we can't protect human sources is the day the American people start becoming less safe.
The ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee telling reporters he's concerned the DOJ may have capitulated and expressing concern about the White House's involvement in that meeting.
This cannot be a conduit to supply investigatory materials to the Trump legal defense team. That would be a terrible abuse of power.
Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer stressing that if the meeting does occur, quote, it must be bipartisan in order to serve as a check on the disturbing tendency of the president's allies to distort facts and undermine the investigation and the people conducting it. Close Trump ally Republican Mark Meadows calling the Inspector General review a step in the right direction, but warning that the Justice Department's attempt to circumvent this responsibility won't go unnoticed. Nunes hasn't commented about the proposed meeting, but he said on Sunday that he won't meet with the Justice Department until he gets information about the confidential source.
We're not going to go to another meeting where we don't get documents.
President Trump praising Nunes at the CIA Monday.
A very courageous man. He's courageous. Congressman Devin Nunes. Thank you very much, Devin, for being here.
Now, Chris and Allison, there is a lot to unpack there, but what's at the root of all of this is a political fight over the Russia investigation, and the president now trying to undermine that investigation by questioning the credibility of the investigators. All of that is going on as the president is scheduled to meet with the South Korean president here at the White House today for about 2 hours. That comes as there is an increasing amount of concern inside this White House that the potential for that historic summit in Singapore with Kim Jong-un is dwindling.
All right, Caitlin, thank you. Let's bring in the panel to discuss the issues. CNN political analyst John Avlon, CNN national security commentator and former chairman of the House Intel Committee, Mike Rogers. Mike Rogers,
sir.
Good to see you.
Great to see you. I just want to go back to Love is Love from Allison.
We love love. I am so loved up, Mike, from the royal wedding that I am going to continue saying that until it wears off, which might be it.
I think you should run down to Congress right now and offer your Love is Love and I Love Love. I think this will solve a lot of problems.
Okay.
This is going to be great.
Thank you.
Go ahead. In the meantime, on the opposite end of the emotional spectrum, I just believe we have a little bit of a different problem right now, which is what's about to happen here has to be a problem to you. What do you see as the potential concerns once this egg is broken? And the politicians go in there and start asking the FBI what they did and calling them spies and calling out their methods. And we know why they're doing it, Mike. This isn't in the interest of democracy. This is to protect the president.
Yeah, I'm very concerned about the political element reviewing source materials, especially for individuals who probably don't know how to handle that information. I would guarantee you that the leak is going to be on. The best solution here is to let Michael Horowitz, who's already demonstrated that he can do a fair and
the Inspector General.
The Inspector General.
Appointed under Obama.
Yeah, and you know, this is the guy that came out and said McCabe lied and actually referred him for criminal charges. That's serious. And by the way, if you're a defense attorney, that's manna from heaven, because he's one of the guys that signed the affidavit for the search warrant into the certain aspects of the Trump campaign. So all of that is for the defense is great. And it tells you that he can be fair and balanced in that in his investigation. What I worry here is
the facts. These are not the actions of an innocent person. This shows consciousness of guilt. It's a bit of a nightmare, and it has been for the past couple of weeks.
It shows me the power of God, the power of our earth.
The cracking continues with the
separation of powers. That to me is really, really important here. And they ought to work to protect it. I'm not sure this is the way to do it.
Mike, I just want to stick with you for 1 second because you're the perfect guest, okay? Because you were the chair of the House Intel, which is what Devin Nunes is, and this involves the House Intel Committee, and an FBI special agent for many years, okay? So you are the perfect nexus for this story. Explain to me how the FBI using a confidential source to investigate a crime is spying. How can they even make that leap of logic?
Yeah, so here's where
the facts. These are not the actions of an innocent person.
So
this shows consciousness of guilt.
It's a bit of a nightmare, and it has been for the past couple of weeks. It shows me the power of God, the power of our earth.
The cracking continues, but this is far from being over.
We're ready to pretty much leave there in 10 minutes and say goodbye to everything.
This is New Day with Chris Cuomo.
We want to welcome our viewers in the United States and around the world. This is New Day.
I can't believe what I just heard. You need to know this. It doesn't sound like a lot, but that is a significant difference. And I think what the Trump administration is trying to say here is he was tasked to go meet these people and elicit information.
You call that spying?
I mean, I wouldn't call it spying. I do think it raises some questions. If you're tasking someone in a political campaign, that is really, really sensitive stuff.
But just to be clear, because they already had a notion that crimes were being committed, thanks to George Papadopoulos telling an Australian diplomat who then reported it to the FBI, they already were worried that there was some sort of Russian influence in crime being committed. Isn't this the same as using a source to go into, I don't know, MS-13 and see what kind of crimes were going on?
Yeah, you're right. And here's the other kind of subtle the difference in all of this matters. That's why I worry that somebody just looking at the documents is going to run out with their hair on fire. But if one of those people, remember, one of those individuals, Carter Page, was already under suspicion of working with the Russians prior to the campaign at all. And so if you had a source who could, and you're working a case to try to say, is this guy under the influence of Russian intelligence officials and doing some work for them back in the United States, that's a problem. If they had somebody who could brush up against that person and find out what his activities were related to that particular crime, then that's not spying, and it's not spying on the Trump campaign.
Context
so
is going to be very important here.
Yeah.
There's no question
Huge.
About it on two levels. I mean, obviously, the Trump campaign is an MS-13. There'd be very different things. I don't.
No, I'm talking about when a crime is, when you have right. Reason to believe a crime is being committed, the FBI sends agents undercover to try to see if a crime is being
they
committed.
They do it different ways. And that's something that you're going to learn more about here. But also, the context matters of how it was conducted. Listen to Sam Clovis.
Campaign.
Context
so
is going to be very important here.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no question
Huge.
About it on two levels. I mean, obviously, the Trump campaign is an MS-13. There'd be very different things. I don't.
No, I'm talking about
on.
When a crime is, when you have right. Reason to believe a crime is being committed, the FBI sends agents undercover to try to see if a crime is being
they
committed.
They do it different ways. And that's something that you're going to learn more about here. But also, the context matters of how it was conducted. Listen to Sam Clovis, who was a Trump campaign official who talked with this confidential source. This is how he described the experience.
The meeting was very high level. It was like two faculty members sitting down in the faculty lounge talking about research. And there was no indication or no inclination that this was anything other than just wanting to offer up his help to the campaign if I needed it. It was not anything other than him talking about the research that he had done on China, and that was essentially what the discussion was about. And we already had a lot of China people involved.
Now, we don't know who else this confidential source spoke to, but this is bad evidence for the defense, to use Mike's analogy, for the Trump folk.
Right.
This is their guy on Monday describing the experience. This is not helpful to them in painting this dark picture of someone manipulating their folks.
No, this does not paint a picture of a conspiracy, which is what they're trying to achieve. Sam Clovis not sticking to the script there. But the reason this larger showdown matters so much isn't only because this kind of information depends on context, as you say, and perspective, but also
the context matters of how it was
conducted.
And
that's what I think we've got to
listen to Sam Clovis
between, unfortunately, the Devin Nunes-led House Intelligence Committee and the House Intelligence Committee that Mike Rogers led. The partisanship has seeped in further. There is unfortunately every reason to believe there won't only be leaks, but potentially back-channeling to the White House, as Devin Nunes has been accused of before in the context of this investigation. And it undercuts not only the separation of powers between Congress and the president, but also it's a direct assault on the independence of the Justice Department and the prosecutorials. And if the Trump team's tactic, strategy, is to investigate the investigators, this further not only puts that assault, not that independence under assault, but has a toxic partisanship that's going to infuse this entire process even further and get us further from the simple search for truth that it should be.
You know, Mike, they are accusing the FBI of having done things for political purpose, but we know that the Trump administration is using some of this for political purposes because they've sent out an email for support,
yes.
For financial support. They've seized upon this. The wording is, in all caps, this could be the greatest political scandal in American history. The president in an email says, I hereby demand, that's very official language, that the Department of Justice investigate whether Obama's FBI and DOJ infiltrated or surveilled our campaign for political purposes. They're trying to fundraise off of this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I mean, you know, you should be outraged and send me $25. That's kind of what that's all about. Two things here that struck me, and even in Sam Clovis, who I knew and watched work with the Trump transition, he basically laid out a case where somebody who had been very active in presidential campaigns was looking to get engaged in the foreign policy in a presidential campaign. I think that's pretty damning to this notion that there's some greater conspiracy that he was tasked to be there. And I think that'll make it more difficult for I think the Trump people to say that, hey, he was out there soliciting information. He may have been a source on other things. As I said, he may have been tasked to talk to Carter Page because of his Russian connections, or he may have just reached out to these people saying, hey, I have a lot of experience in presidential campaigns, worked at the White House, worked in the United States Senate. And by the way, I can offer you a lot of help on foreign affairs and international relationships. That's the problem you're going to run into this whole thing. And I would say this, Allison, both of those sides, both teams have been out there, Republicans and Democrats, have been out trying to raise money on
sure.
this. No one's not free of that particular, be outraged, send me your money.
They're so desperate for money, yeah. Mike, that they put us reporters on their lists. I can't tell you how many Democrat and Trump solicitations I get asking me for money with these ridiculous pitches. And but, they're putting us on the list.
But it's information.
Did it move you so much, Chris, that you had to stop yourself midway from writing the
right.
check?
The emotional pull is impressive.
But the connection between fear-mongering and fundraising is unfortunately fundamental in this time we're in. And it really does expose the tactics and the fact this isn't about a principled outrage. In many cases, this is simply playing to the base and plumbing them for cash.
And they better change their description because, somebody who's creating this rhetoric is being too accurate. They're saying you spied on us for political purposes, right. which is what a lawyer would think about it. Their problem is it wasn't for political purposes. They spied on you because you were open for business with the Russians. And they were told that and they saw evidence of it and they started to look. That's the concern with this kind of narrative. It's going to blow back in their face.
All right. On that note, Mike, John, thank you very much.
Love is love, Allison.
Thank you. Thank you. We still feel that way even after this segment. Another meeting involving Donald Trump Jr. ahead of the 2016 campaign is now under the microscope. This is different than the meeting with the Russians in Trump Tower. Did House investigators who interviewed the president's son months ago know about this discussion with an envoy for Gulf princes? We ask a member of the House Intel Committee next.
Jesus.
And a very courageous man. It's courageous. Congressman Devin Nunes. Thank you very much, Devin, for being here. Appreciate it.
That was President Trump praising Congressman Devin Nunes. Nunes is expected to be one of the lawmakers who will see highly classified information from the Department of Justice and the FBI that he's been clamoring for, but it's still unknown what that information will include. So joining us now to discuss all of this is Democrat on the House Intelligence Committee, Congressman Jim Himes of Connecticut. Good morning, Congressman.
Good morning, Allison.
Are you comfortable with Devin Nunes seeing highly classified information from the FBI and DOJ?
Of course I'm not. Of course I'm not. Nobody should be, right? Devin Nunes for a year now has acted as the defense attorney for President Donald Trump. He's thrown every variety of spaghetti on the wall, and it goes back to trying to help the president prove that Obama wiretapped him in Trump Tower, to the unmasking scandal, to the Steele dossier being the start of the investigation. All of that stuff turned out to be 100% false. What's scary about this, Allison, is first of all, well, most importantly, we're talking about sources here, right? So today in my home state of Connecticut, there are law enforcement people at the FBI who are going to drug gangs, and they're trying to get people to be informants. And they're telling those people, look, we might pay you. You're going to do the right thing. We will protect your identity. And of course, there's CIA officers all over the world in places like Baghdad going around saying, helping keep us safe by recruiting sources. What Devin Nunes is doing and what a couple of my Republicans are doing, they are sending a signal around the world that some quirky, completely factless investigation may cause you as an informant or you as a CIA asset to be exposed. And that is going to make us profoundly less safe abroad and at home.
Well, this is exactly the point. Do you see anything strange about the FBI using a confidential source to try to see if there were any crimes being committed in the Trump campaign?
Of course not. I mean, look, Mike Rogers, you had him on before, Republican former chairman of the Intelligence Committee, showing huge concern with this. I sometimes do this mental experiment, Allison, where I say, let's imagine these crew of Republicans, Devin Nunes and Mark Meadows and Jim Jordan. Let's imagine that a President Hillary Clinton or a President Barack Obama, that individual's people had been in Europe telling people in bars that they were taking information from the Russians, that there was lots of evidence of a meeting between Hillary Clinton's daughter and Russian government people to sell. They would be pounding the table not just for the use of informants, but we'd have articles of impeachment before the House today. So this is just a massive exercise in hypocrisy. And the problem here is that it's a very dangerous one for American national security and for the rule of law in this country.
So what does Devin Nunes want?
Devin Nunes, for a year now has, and look, this is not a secret, has acted as the defense for the President of the United States. And it's a terrible thing to see because it's badly damaged the Intelligence Committee. I will tell you that there's Republicans on that committee who are no happier than the Democrats are that the chairman of that committee has turned it into the committee to protect the President. That is not what we are supposed to do. And by the way, it ends badly. Again, you know, take a big step back, Allison. Remember the whole premise that the FBI is somehow prejudiced against Donald Trump. You know, there's an argument to be made that Jim Comey, the head of the FBI, prevented Hillary Clinton from becoming president. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but there's a strong argument to be made that when he went out talking about the investigation into Hillary Clinton twice, not once, but twice before the election, he fatally damaged her chances. At the same time, remember, there is this investigation going on of Donald Trump, which Jim Comey says absolutely nothing about. So the whole premise that, that this is some deep state conspiracy against Donald Trump is belied by every single fact from the moment that Jim Comey came out to talk about the Hillary Clinton investigation.
Okay, next topic that also includes your House Intel Committee. 3 months before the 2016 election, Don Jr. hosted a meeting at Trump Tower. This is different than the meeting with the Russians, okay? We're just learning about this meeting. This meeting was arranged by the Education Secretary Betsy DeVos's brother, Eric Prince, and it involved an emissary for Saudi Arabia, Arabian Prince and a UAE Prince. When Eric Prince testified in front of your committee, he said that he had very little connection to the Trump campaign. Yeah, thank you. Now that you know about this meeting, was he being truthful?
Yeah, exactly. One of many questions I have about this meeting, and let's be clear, we don't know exactly what happened in that meeting. We don't know if anything that happened in that meeting was illegal, but it raises all sorts of questions. Yes, you know, Eric Prince, and you can read the transcript, because this is one of the few transcripts that the Republicans have permitted to be released of my committee's proceedings, and he basically says, no, I had negligible contact with the campaign, or no contact. I can't remember quite the language, but yeah, there's a very real possibility that he wasn't being straight with Congress. Look, there's questions about whether this Israeli social media type who was there has connections to Russian oligarchs. I'm interested in why the Emiratis and the Saudis apparently sent representatives to say we want to help elect Donald Trump. We should all scratch our heads around those questions. And it all points to one thing. There are no conclusions, but there are lots of questions. How do you answer questions? With an investigation. And this is why I don't understand the president's attack on this investigation. If he succeeded in closing it down tomorrow, the myriad of questions that are out there would hang over his presidency for as long as it was here. There's only one way for somebody who's innocent to be proven innocent, which is to let the investigation run its course. And if the facts show that the president and his people did nothing, let the investigation tell the American people that and we can move on. Instead, Donald Trump is acting like a guy who knows that an investigation is going to uncover some pretty ugly stuff.
And very quickly, Congressman, do you have a way to figure out if Eric Prince perjured himself in front of your committee?
Well, this isn't a hard thing, right? I mean, you know, the transcript is there for everybody to review. The participation of Eric Prince in this meeting in Trump Tower will presumably become more clear over time. But I will tell you that as long as the Republicans are in charge of the House without any interest at all in pursuing this, in fact, devoting their resources to ending this investigation, if there was perjury, it will not go punished.
Congressman Jim Himes, thank you very much for all the perspective.
Thank you, Allison.
Chris.
All right, so has President Trump's battle with the Justice Department gone too far? Will Republicans stand up to him? A Republican representative who just left office, Charlie Dent, joins us next. All right, look, doesn't matter what your political stripe is, the truth is clear. The president is taking the fight to the Justice Department. He is going to go after the people who he believes are going after him. And it's raising questions about if he's crossing the line, will his own party speak up? Joining us now is CNN's newest political commentator, former congressman from Pennsylvania, Charlie Dent. It's good to see you, sir. Thank you for your service to the country. Welcome here. Forgive me if this seems cynical. Call it out if so. But I think that's a rhetorical question. Will Republicans stand up against the president? The answer is no. They are assisting him. Devin Nunes. Other members of this kind of formative cabal of people who want to prove that the administration of justice is dirty in this country. No Ryan, no McConnell, silence this morning. Your party is going to let him do what he wants to do here, yes or no?
Well, for the moment, I think that's true. But the midterms will be a seminal test. I mean, this could be a very difficult midterm election, and I suspect after that election, some views might change. I think we have to conduct much more rigorous oversight, and I've been concerned about this. You know, I thought, you know, the Intelligence Committee in the House right now certainly is not functioning like it should. When Mike Rogers was there, I mean, it had a lot of respect, and it functioned very effectively with Dutch Ruppersberger. But today, you know, it's a bit of a morass.
Mike Rogers says that he does not see the cause for concern here, that this was spying. He says this was more pro forma, and the concern is, what did the FBI have that made them feel that they needed to use a confidential source to start making points of contact to coordinate information? But he says the answer is easy: an inspector general, Horowitz, the guy who just threw McCabe under the bus and gave a criminal reference. Let him look at it. Don't have politicians do it. Your say.
Well, sure. Of course, an inspector general makes sense. You know, I served overseeing the VA. We had a very aggressive inspector general there and issued a very harsh report on the secretary at the time, Dave Shulkin. So I've seen inspector generals do a good job. That's the process. If you're concerned about the conduct in a particular department, empower the inspector general to do an investigation. That's the right way to proceed. Absolutely.
Where do you think this goes?
Right now, my view is I've been saying all along that the president just simply ought to let Mueller do his job, stop interfering. And as Trey Gowdy has often said, if you're innocent, act like it. And I think these interventions, I think, just cause more questions and more problems for the president than anything else. I think you should just leave it alone.
The president has cover, though, because he has Devin Nunes and other Republicans who are saying, no, we're concerned, too. Deep state, dirty justice. We have to get after it.
Well, I think at the end of the day, Chris, what they've done very effectively, the administration, is they tainted the investigation politically, so that whenever there's a finding, some will be able to say, oh, it's all fake. It was a witch hunt. But that doesn't protect people legally. I mean, if you know, people have already been indicted and pled. So, you know, maybe on the politics, they've scored some points. But legally, that's a different matter. People still have to sweat.
However, we're probably looking at a situation, I could be completely wrong, but we're probably looking at a situation where the special counsel is going to issue his report to the deputy AG, Rosenstein. Parts of it or all of it will be then released publicly. And it won't be about criminal implication. It'll be about political implication. And if you don't have any basis of mutual recognition of truth, what good is that report?
Well, that'll be up to the American people. They're going to look at that report, and they're going to expect their members of Congress to deal with it. And I don't know I have no idea what Mueller is going to find. But if it's very serious, this is going to be a decision then for those members of the House to determine what action they want to take, if any. And again, I don't know if this report's going to occur before the midterm. I suspect not. It'll probably be after the midterm. And, you know, you could have a different balance of power in Congress after this midterm. So I think ultimately the House of Representatives and the Senate are going to be the ones who are going to have to make a hard decision.
As a Republican, do you want to see President Trump sit down with Mueller?
Well, again, if I were his lawyer, I would certainly advise against it. As a political matter, it's probably better for the president to sit down. Again, if he has nothing to hide, what's he afraid of? So politically, probably better to sit down. But legally, I think it'd be a very dangerous strategy.
Now, people hear that and they think, well, that's because as a lawyer, you would know that Mueller's out to trap him and get him, and that this is a sneaky process and the president should be above this. Is that why you would advise him against it?
Well, I think because from time to time, I think it's fair to say the president, you know, can misrepresent facts. I mean, let's face it. He does that fairly regularly. And when you're sitting down, you know, with this type of investigation and this type of pressure, you have to be very precise in your language, very careful about everything you say, and make sure your facts are right. And let's face it, our president hasn't always been very accurate with the facts.
So let me get your insight into something while I have you. Bill comes up called the Farm Bill, so people will think it's about farms. But then there was all of this political machination going on within this bill about the poor and different types of funding and different perspectives, and it finally got voted down, but it seemed like it was a real window into a state of dysfunction in the government. You were part of that process. What was that bill about? Why did it go down? What does it mean?
Well, because a decision was made to run a Republican-only, a partisan farm bill. Typically, it's done on a bipartisan basis. So when you run a bill like this on a partisan basis, that empowers the hard right. And so 25 of those members can take the bill down. So what happened is some on the hard right voted against the bill over immigration. You had some from the center who voted against it because of the changing the eligibility for food stamps or SNAP, as they call it now. So you had this combination of people. I was one of the guys who was concerned about the bill, too. I said, we're going to do welfare reform for lower-income people, but we're not going to do welfare reform for sugar growers. And so I was one of the guys causing some problems. The bottom line is, if you run a partisan-only bill, you empower those on the hard right, and they were able to take down the bill. And this bill, by the way, on a partisan basis, it was going nowhere in the Senate. They're running a bipartisan bill over there. Senator Roberts and Stabenow are running a bipartisan bill, and so they're going to have all the leverage. So I didn't understand the point of the exercise. It makes the House look weaker and puts the Senate in the driver's seat.
Where was the farm part in this farm bill?
Well, 80% of the farm bill really deals with nutrition and the supplemental, the food stamp benefits, largely. That's where most of it is. The farm, I mean, we have all sorts of supports for crop insurance to the growers, and particularly for the commodity growers. And I represent Pennsylvania. I represented Pennsylvania, and we are a big confectionery state, so I was one of the guys who wanted to get rid of the price supports for sugar growers and be pro-consumer, but we could never get any reforms there. So there's a lot of fighting over, you know, just how much support we should give to the growers and how much support, of course, we should give the people who are low income.
It's just so interesting for people to get a window into the process where something's called a farm bill, but it's largely about food stamps or SNAP. Yeah. And then there are all these immigration things that people are trying to sneak through under the guise of something that's supposed to be about something else.
And that's all, believe me, and that's the other thing, too, on immigration. One of the challenges with immigration right now is the agricultural piece. If we go to a mandatory e-verification mm-hmm. system and without any type of agricultural visa reform, our farmers are going to rebel.
Yeah. The big weakness to those who say they're a hard line on immigration is, why do you never go after the people who hire the people illegally? That part's never in it. We'll see if it is this time.
Thank you.
Mr. Dent, it is good to have you. Welcome to the
team. Great to be with you.
All right. Allison.
Okay, Chris, she would make history with a win. So how does an African-American woman running as a Democrat in Trump country plan to win the governor's seat in Georgia? That's next. Voters in four states are casting their ballots today as the 2018 midterms continue to take shape. Among the most watched races, the one for Democratic nominee for governor of Georgia. One candidate wants to become the nation's first black female governor. And CNN's Kyung La has more.
And I'm running for office, not
Choice
for me,
2018
but for the
is brought to you by the American Petroleum Institute.
She's the Democratic candidate for governor, but in the heart of rural Georgia, a Republican stronghold, watch Stacey Abrams.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Pose for photos, receive hugs, even tears.
Will his own party speak out?
The border here is white.
We're in Trump country.
Oh,
you
yes.
think that you can win here?
So here's the thing. I've got to win Georgia. That means I've got to turn out more Democrats everywhere. We're in Trump country. But here's the thing. They're driving around. We're doing something.
Abrams determined to pull off something no black woman has ever managed to do in Georgia or the entire country.
She has never been governor in this state.
No. No, she has ever been governor. But I intend to change that this year.
Trying to crack the ceiling in a place that once shut her out. In 1991, as her high school's valedictorian, Abrams was invited to the governor's mansion.
What happened on that trip? The security guard refused to allow us inside. He said that it was a private event. This man who had this power in front of the most powerful place in Georgia, telling me I don't belong there. And that's resonated for me for the last 20 years.
Me become the next governor of the great state of Georgia.
Abrams plans to do that by taking the blue wave on overdrive, doubling down on the Democratic base, women and minorities, from black voters to Latinos and white progressives, with an emphasis on direct grassroots and volunteer contact. In every corner of Georgia.
You cannot ignore those who already agree with you but feel like you don't respond or reflect their values. We cannot win by pretending to be something we're not.
Don't tell me we can't spread progressive messages.
The other Stacey in the Democratic race disagrees.
My opponent, on the other hand, thinks you just focus on Democrats. And if we just get all Democrats out, we'll win. And in a state like Georgia, I don't think that's enough. I don't think the math adds up. And I also just don't think it's healthy for democracy.
Stacey Evans is also vying for the Democratic nomination, would also make history as Georgia's first woman governor. But Evans believes she needs to expand the base in a year of Republicans souring on Trump.
I'm Stacey Evans, and as governor,
investing in TV early and heavily.
And I think we should take our progressive message to persuade those that are living in suburban communities that maybe have tended to vote Republican, that there is something for them on the Democratic side that's going to make their lives better.
Two Stacys forging two different paths across this southern state, both driven by the same vision, a woman in Georgia finally leading the way. Kyung Law, CNN, Atlanta.
All right, our thanks to Kyung Law on that report there. Now, we're going to tell you about this. Another explosive eruption reported at Kilauea Summit. Look at the pictures. I know they're getting familiar, but imagine if you were living there. And now you have this dangerous ash plume over surrounding areas. The lava flow is so intense that it has now reached a geothermal plant as it pours into the ocean along the coastline. CNN meteorologist Chad Myers joins us live with the latest. What does that mean that it's now reached geothermal levels?
Well, if the lava goes to the left or uphill, then we get into the geothermal plant itself. Or if the fissure breaks in a little farther uphill spot, then we get lava into the plant and it will be destroyed. The plant is shut down. 12 out of the 13 or 11 out of the 12 wells are in good shape. They are quenched. They're done. But what you see behind me, Chris, these are live pictures. And I've been watching this. I've been mesmerized by this since 4 o'clock this morning. Live pictures from a guy's house about 1,000 yards. And if you listen to it on the internet, you can actually hear birds chirping and you can hear the explosions from this. But we talked about this now for just a second. Let's get to the graphics because it is the ash cloud that everyone can see. And you can't fly planes through it. You don't want to breathe this stuff in. This is the main threat for the area. But there are other threats that are slightly more hidden. This laze we talked about yesterday. It's the hydrochloric steam. It's ash. It's glass in the air that you cannot breathe. It's absolutely deadly to you. And then, of course, the sulfur dioxide. I've heard some reports that some of this acid rain is a pH of 1.5. Now, that's a number you can't even get your head around unless you think about battery acid. And that's what's falling on some of these showers in places around the volcano.
Okay, Chad, that gives us a lot of understanding about why it's so dangerous there. We have a geophysicist coming up to tell us more from Hawaii. Thank you very much. Meanwhile, Senator John McCain has a new book out. It's already making waves. Our Dana Bash talked to the co-author. Their message for Americans coming up.
Your new day weather.
New memoir, The Restless Wave. It comes out today. The Arizona senator, as we all know, is fighting a very aggressive form of brain cancer, and he has been very reflective of late on his 60 years of public service. CNN chief political correspondent Dana Bash joins us now. She sat down with McCain's co-author, a longtime aide and speechwriter. What did you learn, my friend?
Well, Chris, you know, it is well known worldwide that John McCain is a war hero. It's known that he was a presidential candidate, a scrappy fighter in the U.S. Senate. But what's less known is McCain's love of literature. He's a voracious reader, and that's fiction and also history. So it's no surprise that he has one more thing to add from his own life for the history books.
They're more partisan, more tribal.
John McCain wanted to give this speech about Senate dysfunction before his brain cancer diagnosis last summer. Then, longtime aide, speechwriter, and friend Mark Salter got a call from McCain with a sudden urgency.
You know, you coming out here, what's the story? And I said, yeah, well, here's what I want to say in the speech. And I said, well, have you gotten the results back? You know, what is it? He goes, it's not good.
Salter rushed to Arizona. They finished the speech on the flight back to D.C.
What have we to lose by trying to work together?
And they all stayed in their chairs for his speech. That had never happened in his career, and it meant a great deal to him.
McCain and Salter were already working on their seventh book together, which instantly took a reflective turn.
He wanted to be more personal and to convey just how fortunate he believed he was for being able to serve his country for 60 years.
The result? The restless wave.
I want to talk to my fellow Americans a little more, if I may. My fellow Americans, no association ever mattered more to me.
This book allows McCain to tie up some loose ends, publicly admitting for the first time that during his 2008 presidential run, Joe Lieberman was his first choice for his running mate.
We all knew it, covering him, but him saying it is a whole different thing.
His aides, and among them myself, had persuaded him that it wouldn't be possible.
They told McCain putting a Democrat turned independent on a Republican presidential ticket would spark a convention revolt.
He wanted to pick Joe Lieberman, but he has never expressed any regret, not privately, nor certainly publicly, about picking Governor Palin.
McCain also explains being approached in 2016 with the now famous dossier about Donald Trump.
He went over to see the FBI director at his earliest convenience and delivered it to him and said, "I assume you will vet this."
I discharged that obligation and I would do it again. Anyone who doesn't like it can go to hell.
I wrote that, but he said it just that way.
During his nearly four decades in Congress, McCain sparred with presidents in both parties, but makes clear his concerns about Donald Trump are fundamental, writing, "The world is learning to live without our active leadership. That's not good for the world, and it won't be good for us." A Vietnam prisoner of war for 5.5 years, brutally tortured for most of it, McCain wants this book to be a guide for standing up for oppressed people around the globe, as he's done for decades.
He goes to Burma and he meets with three guys who had been political prisoners for 20 years, had just been released from prison. And when he started to speak, one of them just started to cry because they had heard his voice on Radio Free Asia so many times defending them by name.
For over 30 years, Salter has helped McCain convey his essence.
You've written a lot of words for and with John McCain. What do you think the most important are?
We were born to love, and we were born to have the courage for it. So be brave. The rest is easy. I thought that was the most McCain-esque thing he ever said.
That, or maybe this, in the final chapter.
We need each other. We need friends in the world, and they need us. The bell tolls for us, my friends.
That, of course, is a reference to For Whom the Bell Tolls by Ernest Hemingway, McCain's favorite book of all time. The fictional protagonist, Robert Jordan, is a larger-than-life romantic war hero who's been a North Star for McCain his entire life. And in the last full page of this book, Chris, after talking about how lucky he has been to have lived a long, great life of passions, fought in war, helped make peace, McCain says goodbye with the quote you see on the screen from Hemingway's Robert Jordan. "The world is a fine place and worth fighting for, and I hate very much to leave it."
Oh, it's going to mean so much, especially right now in the context of everything the senator is battling. You and I both know people who are close to him. People have been going out there to visit. Mm-hmm. They've been having some remarkable experiences with their old friend, and many are seeing a side of him that they never saw before.
That's right, because, I mean, the title, Restless Wave, is actually a quote in the Naval Hymn, but it also describes John McCain. He is the most restless person anybody has ever met, but that is not possible with this kind of brain cancer he has. So he has been spending his days, as you said, greeting visitors, longtime friends who come out there. He's got good days and bad. One of the things that his family has done is given him a schedule. As you know, somebody who is in public office especially, they have a schedule that they keep in their pocket down to the minute. He's got that as well. But you know, Chris, what he's doing right now is he is sitting by the creek in the home that he loves, the only home he's known, watching the Hawks and trying to find as much peace as he can.
Well, we wish him and the family well, and I'm sure this book is going to be well received. And he loved the main character, and he loved the guide, and Selmo. And Selmo is Robert Jordan's guide in Whom the Bell Tolls.